نہ تیرا خدا کوئی اور ہے نہ میرا خدا کوئی اور ہے نہ تیرا خدا کوئی اور ہے نہ میرا خدا کوئی اور ہے یہ جو راستے ہیں جدا جدا یہ معاملہ کوئی اور ہے.
اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم, بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم, الحمد للہ رب العالمین, والصلاۃ والسلام خاتم النبیین, و بعد, السلام علیکم ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ. Welcome to another new episode of Building Bridges Between the Faiths with myself, Rafiq Hassan, and the ITV team here. And we thank all the avid viewers out there, and keep the viewership going, spread the word around, tell the people to gather together, you know, on the Sunday evening, 8 to 9, and also it's rebroadcast on a Wednesday morning, where we get to understand one another and build the bridges of understanding between the various faiths. I think the world needs more than ever before to understand one another, to accept one another's differences. It's there, it's a reality. We respect the differences. Even if we don't want to accept the differences, then at least respect people's views. And I think what has been also coming as a result of the last two episodes, you know, we had this series of two-part episode on does the Quran promote violence and what have you. And I think questions that were coming up, and we thought we'll address it immediately. And that is the whole question of, you know, what drives people to extremism and violence. And I think this is a very, very good question, you know. What drives people to extremism and violence? Now, this is a very deep topic, and I think it is very relevant. I want to say right up at the beginning that this is not dependent on any religion. Doesn't matter what religion a person is, Muslim, Christian, Hindu, Buddhist, Marxist, you know, even a Marxist, even secular groups, people within those groups are driven to extremism and violence. The world, we are witnessing this. All sectors, you name it, and you'll see. So it's got nothing to do with the philosophy or the religion that is being there, right? So let's get that straight. It's to do with the way the individual is perceiving what is in his religion or her religion. It's the way the individual is programmed into understanding that religion or that way of life or that philosophy. So at the end result, what I am saying, one of the very important, this is the one factor we are giving. There are two reasons. We're going to give two reasons. There are more. There are going to be more. But we're just giving like two main reasons that drives people to extremism and violence. This is what this episode will deal with. And that is to do with what we call the way we are conditioned or programmed or understand, made to understand. 9 out of 10 times, if you're not critically thinking, if you're just accepting what's being told to you, you know, like a robot, then that's what you're going to produce, because you're not critical. One is not critically evaluating. One is taking things too literally. You understand? And these are some of the factors. One is closed in a box. We are in one box. And for me, that box is the whole world. It's my way or the highway. I've got the truth by me, and nobody else has got it. And I'm the right one, and everybody else is wrong. Now, one has to understand it's the way we are educated and the way we are brought up into things, the way we define issues, the way we understand issues, the way our mind is made to accept things. Do you know the mind is so powerful? So that's the one reason. It's all to do with education, social conditioning, our own upbringing, and a lot of factors that's to do with the individual. There is another factor that drives people to extremism and violence. I'm giving this is at the individual level. The second one is given by Dr. Ian Pape. Dr. Robert Pape did a lot of studies on suicide bombing and extremism, and he's from Columbia University in America. And I think his was a very good article on this, and he's puts down also to a factor which is, one of the answers to this question, is that it is socioeconomic conditions, poor socioeconomic conditions, and denying people their human rights and their rights. You know, people having been denied their human rights, when they are denied that and have no other option, they resort to extremism and violence because there's no other option left to them. You'll find, for instance, on this point, these are the two reasons we are giving why people resort to extremism and violence. There may be more, but the two main reasons are our social conditioning as individuals, our upbringing, our narrow thinking, not critically evaluating what people are telling us, selectively reading texts of the religious texts or any other text of books and not looking at things holistically and broadly. This is the one reason. And the other reason is when people are denied human rights, basic rights, they're not allowed to express themselves in a peaceful way, so they resort to an extreme way by resorting to violence. In fact, Professor Robert Pape actually was saying about suicide bombing in particular. He was mentioning that suicide bombing in his article is not because it's nothing to do with religion. Because people feel that Muslims are suicide bombers and Palestinians, the Islam is making people to be suicide bombers and the Quran is making people to be suicide bombers. And he proved this to be wrong because he says the number one, if he did a whole proper academic research, he's a professor at a research institute, and he says the number one suicide bombers, believe it or not, you know who they are? It is the Tamil Tigers of Tamil Nadu. And these Tamil Tigers are not a religious-based group. It is a Marxist, it is a secular, they got nothing to do with religion. And they are fighting what they believe is a cause with the Indian government and what have you, because they have been denied their homeland. And it's to do with again, people being denied their human rights and the freedom kind of thing. And because they are desperate, they do not have the military might as the enemy or the oppressor, or the person denying them those rights, they resort to suicide bombing. But he extended it by saying, even under normal circumstances, people who are denied the right to protest and the right to express the disagreement with the inhumanity to human beings, then if they are denied those legitimate means, they resort to violence and extremism because they are denied the normal means. You find the father of our nation, Nelson Mandela, who has returned back to his creator, said very well, if those of you followed the Rivonia trial, when you remember when they were arrested, the Rivonia trialists during those dark days of apartheid. And in court, he said, by nature, I'm a non-violent person. But in the context of the South African situation of the apartheid regime, I find it very hard to remain non-violent. You see, it's the violence that and hatred that produces violence. So I think this is something we must consider very well, right up front. And remember again, let's while we're doing this program, let's apply what we are saying are some of the causes of extremism so that we don't become extremist while on the program like this. That we must say, let us be objective, let us be calm, let us be factual, and let us, have an open mind. Another thing drives to extremism is fanaticism. To become fanatical about something to the point that you lose your reasoning faculties. Now, we'll find that, let's give some, I think, while set this tone. I think if you can just see from some of these, some great thinkers, what they had to say about what I've just said. And let's, for instance, it's supposed to be T-E-R-R, that the E is missing, the terrorism. Terrorism is the war of the poor. War is the terrorism of the rich. This is by Leon Uris, 1924 to 2012, an American novelist. This is The Source Trinity, a novel of Ireland. Now look at how he looks at Leon Uris. It's something what Professor Robert Pape is saying. Terrorism is the war of the poor, and war is the terrorism of the rich. This is just, how these are deep thinkers who have looked into. We are trying to find the reasons. Why do people resort to this. And even we're discussing this, keep in mind the conflicts that are going around in the world. And you will find we're going to discuss this. We're going to, you know, there's a very important point, maybe while we're coming to the end of the first segment, you know, before the first invasion of Iraq. I'm just going to tell you what drives people to and radicalizes people. I want us to cast back. You know, human beings forget very quickly. You see, before the first invasion in Iraq, I think it was, 2003, when the George Bush was trying to invade, there was an American senator. I just can't get his name now. He's a very elderly American senator. He stood up in the White House and he told George Bush, he told him, we have one Saddam and we have one Osama bin Laden. We only have one Saddam Hussein and one Osama bin Laden. But if you're going to invade Iraq now and start bombing that country and start to destroy that country, we'll have 1,000 more Saddams and 1,000 more Osama bin Ladens will produce against us. Very wise words. And those words were proven true. Stay tuned. We'll be back after the break. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to this next segment of Building Bridges Between the Faiths. And yes, we are talking about causes. What we are doing this episode is what drives people to extremism and violence. And we are looking at various thinkers who gave some answers. And and this is what I'm sharing with you, how they have seen what's going on in the world. Let's look at this beautiful thing by Gerald Messi. They must find it difficult, those who have taken authority as truth rather than truth as authority. See this now? They must find it difficult, those who have taken authority as truth rather than the truth as the authority. Now, that's a very powerful statement. What this is again saying is what we were saying earlier on, that people are very readily accept things from people of authority and position. You won't believe it, in if you read books on mind control, even Adolf Hitler, if you read his book, The Mein Kampf, and his works, he'll tell you in this thing about influencing the masses, because he was a leader, and how to control the masses. And he says, you know what he said? He says that it is easier to speak a big lie to the public. The public will swallow easier a big lie than a small lie. This is in mass psychology. It will be easier for the public to swallow a big lie rather than a small lie. You know, they'll say, because if somebody from authority is saying something, Osama bin Laden did the Twin Towers, you know, Al-Qaeda did it. And everybody, because it's said by the President of America. And who's going to disagree with that? And yet today, all evidence is pointing against it. You see? So, you know, you have to question, especially the people in authority we have today, is not the kind of, people who are necessarily the best people. There may be exceptions. I'm not saying in all instances. But the world that we are living in today, they say if you want something to be accepted, a lie to be accepted, the truth, you must speak it often enough. You speak a lie often enough, and especially by people of authority, it will be accepted as the truth. It's another principle of mass psychology, of public. You know, you read the headlines, it's all flashing in all the papers. Well, it must be true. See, it's in the front page of the newspaper. It must be true. So this is how the normal average human being thinks. So I think we have to be very careful on and how we go about it. This is a very beautiful saying by an anonymous person concerning what we are talking about, how people are misled. When people who are honestly mistaken, when they learn the truth, now this is a very powerful statement, they will either cease being mistaken or they will cease being honest. When people who are honestly mistaken, when they learn the truth, they have two choices now. Either you must say, I made a mistake and I'm accepting the truth, or you carry on with your mistake, then you'll be dishonest and you cease being honest. You have only two choices after that, you know. And we find that the mark of a real person, of a true person, is you can say, okay, I was wrong. I also, you saw that one of the, I admire some of the comments you get. the pastor from Pretoria. I remember we showed it in the previous episodes and even in the last episode. He wrote in, he says, you know, I thought Muslims were terrorists. I was misled. I am honest about it. I'm admitting I know the truth now. So he's being honest now. You know, I know that the Quran it does not promote violence. I thought it was like that. I was misled. But I'm agreeing it's not so. It's not there. You know, when you come to know the truth, that is why Jesus, peace be upon him, he said, you know the truth and the truth will set you free. But unfortunately, many people don't want to accept the truth. You see, that's the problem. The you know what is the truth? There's always, they say, there's three sides to a story. Again, it's all to do, we are talking about, you know, how people find out who's right, who's wrong, and why they hold on to the extremist views. And we are discussing these issues. But then people always say there's two sides to the story. I say no. There's three sides to a story. There's your side of the story, is my side of the story, and then there's the truth. The truth could be sitting somewhere else. You see, because I maybe got just my understanding of the truth, which may not be correct. And you may have your understanding of the truth, which may not be correct also. Because the truth is something else between other than what me and you may be understanding about it. So it is very important for us to understand. You know, I like what Einstein said. See, mustn't be dogmatic. You know what drives people to fanaticism and extremism is this, you know, this attitude that, you know, my way, I am right and everybody else is wrong. Einstein said, you know, there is no God, but I could be wrong. I could be wrong. See, he leaves it open. Now, that's the mark of a good thinker. Certain things, if you're not sure of, there's nothing wrong in saying, I'm not sure. You know, one of the great scholars of Islam, Imam Abu Hanifa, one of the great scholars, he says, to say I don't know is half of knowledge. It's half of knowledge to say I don't know. You know, it's better to say I don't know, which means you're already starting on a good footing. Means there's something, to say you don't know, you know something, to say I don't know that. It requires knowledge to say I don't know that. So, but people want to make as if I know everything and I got all the answers, you see. So I think these are very important points to remember. It's all to do with education. Also, the right type of education. If you want to ask what drives people to extremism, then we must ask the question, what type of education are people getting at? And it has been rightly said, education is not the name of any degree or certificate that can be shown to others as a proof. But education is the name of our attitude, our actions, our language, our behavior, and our personality with others in real life. See, what is education? You can have all the degrees and professor titles and doctor titles, but you could still be doing inhumanity to man. You could still be dealing unjustly with fellow human beings. You could still be promoting lies and spreading lies and falsehood in the guise of truth. That's not education. You see, you know, just recently, currently, you find that one of the chief heads of Al-Azhar Institute, Al-Azhar in Egypt, which is one of the longest standing Islamic universities and institutes in the Muslim world, and the head of Al-Azhar now as we're speaking, he said that the time has come for Muslim universities and Muslim teaching institutions, what we may call Darul Ulooms, or you know, places of learning where Muslims go and learn to become priests and molanas and imams. It's time that the syllabus starts to take into account and change and to a broader understanding of what is Islam. And he said, in his view, there has to be a teaching that brings about a bigger tolerance of the understanding of what is Islam and different views and acceptance of different views. There are different acceptable views in the house of Islam, and the institutions and the various learning institutes must start to, in their teaching, say that, you know, we hold this view, but the other view is also an acceptable view, and they're entitled, not that our view is right and everybody else is wrong. And this is coming from not just an ordinary person, the head of Al-Azhar Institute, of one of the oldest Islamic universities in the Muslim world. He's saying the time has come, one of the cause. What he's trying to say, he's saying it. It's a big article. Anybody's interested, we can send you the article when In the last segment, we'll give you our details, and we will gladly send you the article that he has written on this. And he says the one of the biggest problems confronting, we talk about the Muslim world. This applies to everyone. Those who are not Muslims, how they're judging Muslims. But he's also talking about how Muslims are judging other Muslim groups. And he is saying, just as we, this Building Bridges program is trying to build the bridges of understanding. That's exactly what we're doing. We are trying to do what he said. You know, we're doing it for the last so many years. What he's saying, that we are trying to say, let's keep our open mind and let us, respect other views, even if we don't accept those views. That's what we've been saying all along. You know, and this is what he's trying to say now. He's saying that the various Muslim universities and institutions of learning have to start with this kind of an approach in teaching the graduates, because most of these graduates are coming out, are starting to throw stones at one another, right? Because thinking they are the only ones that right and everybody else is wrong. So I think this is very important on what we talk about education. Now, I want to give you an example of this as we proceed. Let's just, for instance, when I say don't only listen or learn one part of something. You see, if the problem here is the Quran is very clear that we must learn, everything about something to give a ruling on it. Keep this point in mind, what I'm saying. I can't just read one small book on medicine and say I'm a doctor now. You know, the doctor has to go to so many branches of different medicine, anatomy, botany, zoology. He's got to learn medicine. He's got to learn embryology. He's got to learn pharmacology. So many things he's got to learn, and then he qualifies as a doctor. Now, the same thing applies with religion. You got to learn many things of what the Quran is saying, of what your religion is saying, before you can start making a ruling on kill somebody or don't kill somebody, because you'll make the wrong ruling. Stay tuned. We'll be back after the break. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد. Welcome back. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Yes. We stopped and said that one has to know everything. You know what's the problem? What leads to this? Wrong conclusions. I give you two examples. Why one must have a broad knowledge of a subject, before one passes a ruling. This is what's causing the problem with these extreme groups. They go there and they just pick up the Quran or the Bible or whatever they're reading. They read a few pages and then they made up their mind. Yeah, we must go and kill. We must go and kill whoever we find or what. They're not reading everything in its context and completely. I give you some example. It's like somebody in a dark room. You put a few people in a dark room and they say, what is there? Somebody is feeling, they come out. Somebody will come out and they say, hey, this is a branch of a tree. Somebody goes in there, comes out, he says, no, man, this is the trunk of the tree. Imagine the same room is giving another answer. Somebody goes in there, he says, no, man, this is a hose pipe there. That's the fire engine use when there's a fire. Now, three people went in a dark room and they gave three answers. They were feeling something in the room. When they put the lights on, it's an elephant in the room. So you can well imagine what one person was holding, which part of the elephant, and what answer they gave. Now we need to see with the light. Put the light on. And what is the light on? Remove the box. Remove this attitude that I know everything and I'm right and I'm nobody else. I'm not going to listen to nobody else. Remove that. Say what Einstein said. I believe this, but I could be wrong also about it. Or I give another example. This is very important. The question was, what drives people to fanaticism, to wrong conclusions, to violence? It's because of how they see things and what they think they are seeing is the right and be all and everything. And this was by another very great scholar who's late now, Professor Fazlur Rahman Ansari, rahimullah. He was a traditional Muslim scholar, an alim, a maulana, but he was also an academic. He reached the heights of academic heights in the academic world from his PhD and professorship in philosophy. And he gave a beautiful example of this. He says, we talk about the reasons for this, why people have different visions and are doing wrong things and leading people to wrong conclusions, and therefore they act wrongly and they start to behave wrongly. It's all based on how they are seeing things, their perception. And this doesn't mean that their perception is correct. He says, take three people and put them on a mountain. And put the first one at the foot of the mountain. You put the second person in the middle of the mountain. And you put the third person right on top of the mountain. All right? So three people on the mountain. You tell the guy at the bottom of the mountain, tell me what you see. So he says, I see a tree there. I see a little valley. See some cows there. Okay. The person on the middle of the mountain, tell me what do you see? He says, well, I can see a river. So the person at the bottom says, you are talking lies. There's no river there. So the person at the middle says, but there is a river. The guy at the bottom says, no, there's no river. You're speaking lies. Tell the person top of the mountain, what are you seeing? He says, well, I can see the river entering the sea, entering the ocean. The person in the middle says, you're speaking lies. There's no ocean. There's only a river there. Now I'm asking you, the viewer, who's speaking the truth and who's speaking lies? You see, everyone is speaking the truth, but the guy at the bottom can only see what he can see there. For that person on the mountain, higher up on the mountain, he can scream 1,000 times there's a river. The guy at the bottom will scream 1,000 times there's no river. It is for him to come down, see that education. He needs to come down and educate, pull that person up, tell him, come here and bring him to where he is. When he comes there, the argument is over. The person who was at the bottom will say, hey, there's a river now. I can see it. You've increased the consciousness. You've raised the consciousness. And same, the two of them, the guy on the top must take them to the top. And when he brings them, they'll keep quiet. Ooh, there's the sea there. I can see the sea. The problem, dear viewers, is people are all at the foot of the mountain making all these rulings and making the decisions on big, big issues. They have to climb to the top. Read all the letters. Go reach the highest point in that field of study. Go and read all the verses in the Quran. Read all the verses concerning that subject. Read all the traditions and the scholars and their views before you can come with a judgment and make a decision that this is what I need to do. This is what is lacking. And I think it's important for us to mention this, you know, as in a field, and there's nothing wrong, say, I don't know. Now, I give you an example of what went wrong. For instance, these people who are, you know, there's some Muslim groups, right? I don't like mentioning them because it gives them prominence. They are killing the innocent other Muslims, and they are burning down mosques and churches, and they're claiming to be Muslims and went to an institute and they say, we are right in what we are doing. Now, I'm just going to give you what the very authentic tradition of the Prophet, peace be upon him, and it was a practice of the Salaf al-Salihin, from the Prophet, all the successors of the Prophet, peace be upon him. What did they do? What did they follow about? What was the rules of warfare? Here's the rules of warfare. Let's go and look at it. Ethics and rules in Islam during the warfare. Don't kill women and children. Don't kill the elderly. Don't kill non-combatants. Don't destroy any place of worship like churches and temples, etc. Don't kill animals. Don't destroy the vegetation or pull out trees or plants or animals. Now this is the rules. These are rules that have been practiced by the Prophet, peace be upon him. It was practiced by the first successor to the Prophet, peace be upon him, Hazrat Abu Bakr, radiallahu anhu. It was practiced by Sayyidina Umar, radiallahu anhu, the second successor of the Prophet, peace be upon him, and all the successive righteous, successors to the Prophet, peace be upon him. It was even practiced centuries later, you know, 500-600 years later by Salahuddin Ayyubi, God be pleased with him, rahmatullah alayh. He was from Iraq. He was a Kurd. You remember during the Crusade Wars, 1095, Pope Urban, Pope Urban on his own, you know, made a ruling. God spoke me, I must go and kill all the Muslims now. This is now a crusade war against the Muslim world. And he got everybody listening to him, and they started a massive, in the name of religion, in the name of one command of Pope Urban II, they went around butchering and killing, you know, in the name of God. Of one man who made his own ruling, right? And then when Salahuddin Ayyubi, in that same period when he came, they say when the Christian soldiers, when the Christian crusaders entered Jerusalem, they were running knee-deep in the blood of the Muslims and those Jews who stayed behind. That's how they butchered them and killed them. But when Salahuddin Ayyubi, when he came back and took Jerusalem, not a single blood was shed. He followed these principles you're seeing on your screen. He says, my prophet told me, don't kill women and children. Don't kill non-combatants. And if people surrender, you don't destroy churches. Not a single church site of the Christians was destroyed. Not a single synagogue or religious site of the Jews was destroyed. He left everything intact. Because Hazrat Umar, the second caliph of Islam, when he entered Jerusalem, is exactly what he did. He did not kill anybody, not a single bloodshed, and nobody was, and everyone was granted the religious freedom. Right? No church, no synagogue, no temple was destroyed. Everything was kept, left intact. Now I'm asking, if they read this, for whichever institute, those who are making these rulings now, what do you have to say? Because you haven't come across this, you are trying to now say, you are trying to intellectualize this away, when this is the practice that was there from the time of the Prophet, peace be upon him. And all that is needed, I'm going to give, now let's go a little further. Let's offer some solutions. We're offering some solutions as well. We're telling what are the causes, Let's give people their human rights. Let's come to Professor Robert Pape. The time has come that we need to give people their human rights. If you oppress people and deny them their human rights, you're going to get violence coming to you. So the second solution is grant people their human rights, And that is another root cause that drives people to do all these things. And many people who have studied conflicts all over the world, go and look at it. Look at every conflict that is taking place in the world. People like to say it's religious. I'm not denying there's certain places where religious fanatics and have made religious conflicts and it's still happening. I'm not saying no. But by and large, the root cause of it is denying people their religious rights. And what will allow this to happen is for the others to keep quiet. They say all you need for evil to spread is for good, nice, pious, religious people to sit back and do nothing, and the evil will spread. So another solution, what we are giving is, it's time that people must stand up, people of authority, even me and you and everybody, let us speak the truth, even if it be against our own Muslim brother, our own Muslim community, my own tribe, my own clan, it's got nothing. Right is right. The Prophet, peace be upon him, mentioned this. The Quran mentioned this. You must speak the truth. If it be against your father and your mother and your tribes and your family, you must speak the truth. Stand up for justice. إِعْدُلُوا أَقْرَبُوا لِلتَّقْوَى. Be just. That is piety. And that is why, am I a doer or am I a watcher? That is the question we are asking. Am I a doer or am I a watcher? He who passively accepts evil is much involved in it as he who helps to perpetrate it. That's Martin Luther King. Stay tuned. We'll be back after the break. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد. Welcome back. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Yes, welcome to this last segment of Building Bridges Between the Faiths, where we are answering what drives people to violence, to extremism. And we mentioned two main reasons. One is denying people their human rights and legitimate rights. And the other one is people's wrong understanding of life and of things and of their religious scriptures or their way of life or their beliefs, which makes them to resort to violence and things like that. And we did say that, therefore we have to have proper education, we have to have an open mind, we have to be rational and balanced in the way we look at things and not go to any extreme. We had Martin Luther King, we ended up the last, just before the break, and Martin Luther King, said very well there that, he who passively accepts evil is as much involved as he who helps to, as if it is he who actually perpetrated it. And I think this is very important for us to keep in mind. And while we are at it, seeing that we are in the last sector of this program, let's give our details there. Take your pens out. You can write our details so that you can, give us your comments and give us your suggestions. And let's keep the communication going, because really this is, let it be a two-way program. This is again, you can ask for some of the free literature we have, And we have many episodes that we have done, which is one of the questions that came up, which we'll end with just now. But let's finish this subject about what we're talking about, how, why this, what is going on in the world about the media and the lies and the distortions and our own ignorance. Here's a saying by Chris Hedges, who is actually a prize-winning reporter for the New York Times. He says, it's all about mind control. The military and the press have turned war into a vast video arcade game. Its very essence is dead. The very essence which is dead is hidden from public view. The military and the press have turned war into a vast video arcade game, right? Obviously, he's left out the main thing, but he expects you to know it, that who controls the military. The people who control the military are in the end controlling all these things. And then, you know, there's another beautiful saying here, is while we're on the media, by George Bernard Shaw. And this may sound, he was about 100 years ago, newspapers are unable, seemingly, to discriminate between a bicycle accident and the collapse of civilization. You know, it may sound very trivial. It may sound, some people may say, this is exaggerating the whole issue. But I think when we look at the world today, you'll find that the world, you know, can go and report something. You'll find, you know, a major catastrophe can be happening, but the media won't, you know, just give you few seconds on it and go for length and length to describe something which is irrelevant, you know. And it's all to do, again, about the media and what's going on in the world. And that's how people are, it's all about mind control also. And this mind control is not only from the media. This mind control is also coming from our homes and our educational institutes. So all these things are factors, and we need to, you know, and there's another factor why, you know, for if we know all these things and evil is spreading, all it requires for evil to spread is for good people to sit back and do nothing. Let's look at what William Osler says. He says, by far the most dangerous foe, means enemy, we have to fight is apathy. Indifference from whatever cause, not from a lack of knowledge, but from carelessness, from absorption in other pursuits, from a contempt bred of self-satisfaction. This is the enemy number one. You know, there's two kinds of people, right? There's, as I told you, that we had a saying earlier on. There's one person who finally knows the truth, but because of indifference and apathy and carelessness, no, absorption in other pursuits, I don't want to get involved. I'll just worry about my family and my life and my dream, you know, and I'm not worried about what's going to happen to humanity and my neighbors around me. See, some people have that self-centered attitude. That's also a problem, you know. For evil to spread, all it needs is for good people to sit back and do nothing. So I hope that, you know, this has shed some light and on the issue of, you know, what's been happening. And this Building Bridges is opening up. It's trying, from the beginning when we started this program, we are trying to say, let's open up a bridges of understanding between one another. And we have done a lot. You know, one of the questions that came as we're rounding up is we have done many topics, right? And I'm just going to go through it again for the benefit of others. You know, that these are all available on the ITV website, or you can contact us at IFRI. They are available as individual DVDs, or they can be available as sets of 14 DVDs, you know, like, for instance, Finding the Common Ground, Abraham in the Bible and Quran, similarities between Islam and Christianity, Jesus in the Quran, questions on Jesus, peace be upon him, Islam in the Quran and Bible, five principles of Islam in other religion. You know, the Prophet Muhammad SAW prophesied in the Bible, the Salah, the Muslim Salah, fasting and Hajj in the Bible. We have another set of DVDs. This was also a new series that we've done, Misconceptions and Misunderstandings. All are separate DVDs, or you can buy them in sets. Does Islam promote violence? We spoke about it previously, but we did in different ways, the Prophet, peace be upon him, and his mission, what others say about the Prophet, peace be upon him. We had three episodes on gender equality in Islam compared to Judeo-Christian scriptures, the Ten Commandments in the Bible, similarities between Islam and African traditional religion. We had some interviews with you know, Christian followers of the Christian faith. Then we did a whole series, the third series, on answering this group called Nurul Islam onto the different belief systems between the Christianity and Islam in terms of what's our belief on crucifixion and atonement and Trinity and all that. And then we had a reply to Mario Joseph. We also had a reason why, 13 reasons why, you know, Emmanuel Adebayo, he was one of the Socrates, how he accepted it. You know, there's a whole lot of different topics. We also have, you know, live, we come into the area and we have actually live programs done in various places in the country with mayors, you know, like, for instance, in number 38 in PE, we had outreaches in Escort with the mayor, local mayor in Port Shepston. We had outreaches in Kokstad with the deputy mayor. So, you know, and it's all building bridges, you know, where we just get to understand one another with the local community. So I think what the world needs more than ever before is to get to understand one another. Are we proud as South Africans? South Africa is a window to the world to show that how by sitting together around a table and discussing and compromising in terms of, you know, the bigger picture in life, you know, we can achieve peace. That was in a political compromise, which was necessary because it was the right thing to do for terms of human rights, which is universal. But in religion, if, as I said, we do not have to accept. If you don't have to compromise your belief if you do not want to accept another person's belief. But you respect each other's view. This in religious matters, it can be worked differently, that we can respect views even though we do not accept the views. But let's have this open view. In your local area, call us. We can come and do an outreach. We have got pamphlet stands where we can, you know, give out pamphlets to explain what is it. These are free distribution items. We can come and interact with the local community, you know, set up. Let's start setting up programs of interaction in this field. Let's religious leaders sit together and work with our local government on how to solve the education crisis, how to solve the HIV crisis, you know, how to solve the crime problem. Let us work together in as religious communities to do that. Our government has set up a national interfaith forums, you know, at the national level, provincial level, local level. And I think we need to see this transformed into our communities. It's time that, you know, every day I go to my church and come back home, or every week I go to the mosque and come back home, I do this. But let me start going from my home to my neighbor. Let me start going from my home to the other religious institute and say, look, we are neighbors. Let's work together and build this our community, whatever the local issue communities. Remember the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as we conclude this program, he did that. When he went to Madinatul Munawwara, you know, after the hijrah, when he was persecuted there, one of the first things he did, there were different religious groups. The Muslims were actually in the minority. There were Christians, the Jews were very prominent there at the time. There were the local, Arabs that were there. But he got them all together around the table. And he said, let us as common citizens of Medina, he formed the first constitution, what we call a local government constitution, the world ever knew of, the Sha'ifat al-Madina. And he says, let us as common citizens of Medina, despite what religious group we are, what different tribes we are, let us work together as common citizens for the betterment of the city, to make the city a better city, a cleaner city, a healthier city, a more prosperous city. Likewise, let us do that. Let us make our cities of South Africa a better cities, and our country, South Africa, a better city. And everybody does that, then the world will be a better world to live. Till we meet again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Na tera khuda koi aur hai, na mera khuda koi aur hai. Na tera khuda koi aur hai, na mera khuda koi aur hai. Ye jo raaste hain juda juda, ye maamla koi aur hai.